Blackstone Publishing presents Fade to Black, a Nero Wolfe mystery by Robert Goldsborough. This book is read by L.J. Ganser.
Chapter 1. The whole business started at Lily Rowan's Super Bowl party. If that sounds cryptic, good. I read someplace once that the best way to hook a reader at the start of a story is with something cryptic. So there you are. Anyway, around Thanksgiving, Lily got the idea she should toss a big Super Bowl bash in her penthouse palace on East 63rd, just off Park Avenue. For years, Lily and I have been what some might choose to call special friends. And in all that time, I never detected in her even the merest flicker of interest in pro football. Baseball, basketball, and hockey are different stories. I can always coax her to Shea or the Garden for a game. "Oh, you know me," she said when I expressed surprise about the proposed festivities. "I don't care a fig for the game, for heaven's sake. It's just such a wonderful excuse to get people together in the middle of the winter. At least those who haven't gone off to Gstaad or St. Moritz or the Caribbean." That might sound like place dropping, but given many of the people Lily knows, it's simply accurate reporting. As it turned out, I wasn't all that excited about the Super Bowl myself. Both teams were from burgs more than 1,000 miles from Manhattan, and the strongest defensive weapon each had was a sawed-off field goal kicker with an unpronounceable Middle European name. But never mind the football. The party on that January Sunday exceeded even Lily's usual lavish standards. It drew a shade over 100 of her nearest and dearest friends, at least those who had passed up Switzerland or the islands. A tuxedoed 5-piece band, usually booked into the Churchill Hotel's velvet lounge, made sweet sounds in the sunroom. Red-jacketed mixologists poured drinks at bars in the living room, game room, and den. And waitresses moved through the crowd every 13 seconds with trays of canapés, shrimp, fresh vegetables, quiche, and assorted other goodies. The game itself was on 6 screens in various rooms, although well over half of the guests were more interested in mingling than in rooting for guys in red and gold or brown and white uniforms. The hostess, looking lovely in a light gray number and gold shoes, moved smoothly from cluster to cluster, pausing to talk to everyone, even me, her escort. "See, darling," she whispered, giving me an impish look. "Nobody cares about that damnable game. They are here to eat, drink, dance, and, Lord knows, maybe even gossip."
"Who can quarrel with those lofty goals?" said I, brushing her dusty blonde hair with a hand and enjoying the scent of uninhibited. She drifted off toward another group, and I found myself talking to a couple named Pembroke that Lily and I had sat with at a benefit dinner a couple of years back. They hadn't become any more interesting in the interim, so I excused myself to get a drink at the nearest bar, where I ran into a glum-faced, sandy-haired guy who bore a more than middling resemblance to Robert Redford. He introduced himself as Rod Mills.
"And you're Archie Goodwin, the detective, right?" he asked, sticking out a firm paw. I pled guilty, and while we both stirred our scotches, I inquired as to what he did for a living, to be polite. He shrugged deprecatingly.
"Advertising."
"Would I know your work?" I asked, still in the polite mode.
"You might," he answered, scratching the back of his neck. "Our biggest account, we're Mills Lake Ryman, is Cherr-o-key. You know, the soft drink."
"Sure. Say, didn't I read something in the Times or the Gazette last week about a spectacular Cherr-o-key commercial that's going to be on during the Super Bowl?
Why do you think I'm keeping one eye on that stupid screen? Certainly not because of the game."
He gestured dismally toward the nearest tube. "It's going to be shown at halftime, the network willing. I quit smoking 2 years ago, but God, I could use a cigarette now."
"Rod, come on! I'm getting everybody together in the game room, where they've got the big screen."
The voice was breathless, and it belonged to a svelte creature who probably made most of the men she met breathless, too.
"Hi,"
she bubbled to me, tossing long black hair in a practiced but pleasing manner.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.